Thank you. Church. What a great way to start off a new year. That's with a baptism. We have Brother Dane Holman come down. Dane has come and he wants to profess his faith, a baptism. He's going to start walking with God in this new year. So you guys be praying for him, be with him. And hopefully we'll have a blessing here. So now, Dane, I present you in front of the church. I baptize you now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Well, good morning. Nothing like starting out a day in God's water, is it? Boy, that's a wonderful thing. Glorious, glorious, glorious. Praise God, all to God. We got a couple of announcements this morning. This is Sunday, January the 7th, 24. January the 11th, 10 a.m. at BMBC Ladies Bible Study Lunch at Walker's after. We have a place for you. That's each and every one of you. We got openings. We got bulletins out there on the wall. If you want to go out there and sign up for either nursery workers or choir, we got choir. We got plenty of room. We got chairs. Choir, greeters, security workers, whatever you feel like God's laying on your heart, we got places out there on the wall. You just put your name down there, and we'll get a hold of you. Also, out in the foyer, got a big, huge area out there. It's got mail inside those mailboxes. If you feel like you still haven't picked up all your Christmas cards or anything, take a look inside those boxes for us and get your cards out of the box for us. That should be everything we've got pretty much for this up-and-coming event. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for this day. Thank you for everything you've already blessed us with this morning, Lord. Father, the Sunday school class, Noah, the ark, that was your first saving, and then your son. Father, you continue to save us from ourselves. Thank you so much for sending your son, Jesus. Lord, forgive us where we failed. Get us back here safely. All these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Great to see every single one of you here today. Would you stand with me, please? Let's lift our voices and praise the Lord together.
Strength and honor, give to His holy name.
song, Victory in Jesus. "'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus." I'll sing the first and last verses of this one.
Jesus, Jesus, how I
Stand with me once again. Let's sing Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. Son, go bring my children home, for I want them gathered round my throne. It's time to reap the harvest you have sown. Son, go bring my children home. Son, go bring my children home. Amen. If you'll stand with me once again, we've reached the fellowship time of our service, so we're going to take just a few minutes We're going to sing one verse of Looking for a City, and then as we move around and greet one another and make sure everyone is welcome, the children will go to Children's Church, and then after a few moments, we'll sing the last verse of Looking for a City just before Mylon comes to preach. Here among the shadows. To greet one another. the last. Here we go. In this land of dangers. Oh, sorry. Though we may be strangers in this world of care, looking for a city built above. Looking for a city where we'll never die. There the sainted millions never say goodbye. There we'll meet our Savior and our loved ones too. Come, O Holy Spirit, all our hopes renew. Thank you. Please be seated.
It's horrible getting old. I forgot something this morning. From the bottom of my heart, I apologize. If you have a birthday in the month of January, please stand. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, now that it comes the time of breaking of the bread, Father, and feeding your flock, Father, with what Mylon has studied all week, Lord. And Lord, by the way, thank you for the blessings of his knee getting better through the surgery, Lord, and hiding behind the cross now as he brings your word to your flock, Father, and the ones out there watching today on the net, Father, that needs a spiritual or a physical healing, Lord, let it be your will. Forgive us where we fail you. Get us back here safely. All these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. If you have your Bibles, you join me this morning in God's Word. In 2 Corinthians this morning, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, I'd like to talk about something very special today, a vision for 2024, a vision for 2024. I don't know if you've thought about a vision, but God's Word tells us it's important for us to have vision. That when people don't have visions, man perish, and we need to have a vision for a church, an individual, for our families, for our personal walk with the Lord. We need to have a vision. Now, as you're turning there, and let me make a quick announcement myself. I know some of you may be questioning. We've been busy in 2023. If you didn't know that, you just ain't been around because we have been busy. A lot of great things have taken place. We started taking pictures. Tanya's been taking pictures and took a time out because of Christmas and stuff. But starting next Sunday, if you haven't gotten your picture taken for our directory, she's going to do that again for the next two Sundays. And then we're going to start trying to put that book together. So if you hadn't got your picture taken, please do that next Sunday or the following Sunday so we can get that done. We've just got so many things that God's been blessing us with. It was great to start off the year with a baptism on our first Sunday. Hopefully we can have many, many more from the Sundays to come. In verse 15 of chapter 9 of 2 Corinthians says, thanks be unto God for his unspeakable gift. Well, we have a lot to be thankful for, don't we? And the gifts that he's blessed us with. First of all, his salvation, his forgiveness of our sin. But it is a blessing today to begin a new year, 2024, our first Sunday together, worshiping the Lord. And I hope that we have plans. I hope at the end of the year comes that we will make a statement for the Lord. Accomplishments that have been made in 2024. Now, some of you, as well as myself, have seen many years, and I can't go back and tell you everything that took place in every year. But there's some years that stuck out more than others. In the year 1959, that was a very good year because that was a year I was 24. I can remember that year. I don't remember that happening, but that was a good year because something great happened. My mama finally got me out of her belly, so I came into this world. That was a good year, 1959. I think back about some other years. I think about 1975. 1975, I received the Lord, my personal Lord and Savior. I was baptized. I surrendered to the ministry. So I began preaching in 1975, 49 years ago. That was a great year, and I still think back about that year and things that took place. It was another great year in my life. 1978, I did something that most people never thought was possible. I graduated high school in 1978. I had a lot of teachers that thought that was never going to happen. But I did. I began my life out in this old world from the training that I got. That was a great year for me because I was glad to be out of school, guys. But let me tell you something else. 1979, that was a good year, too. That was the year that Miss Debbie said, I do. And I got married. That was a great year. For me, anyway, it was a great year. But there's a lot of years that I go back and I think about the accomplishments and the expectations that were in the year. In 1982, that was a great year. We had a little addition to our family. Our first daughter came into our home in 1982. That was a great year. 1984 was a great year, too, because that was when the last one came. We said that we're finished. But we can go back through many years and talk about some great things that accomplished. And it's hard to be prepared for everything that's going to happen, but we need to prepare ourselves for what's going to come. Because not all things are great. A lot of things are going to be difficult. And it may be 2024. I can remember 2015. That was the year I lost my mother. I lost my mother. And that was a difficult time. And that year will always be remembered. But the great thing about that is not only did I lose her in this old world, I know that I've got the promise to be together again through Jesus Christ. 2021, that was a big year. I'd been pastoring in Huntsville for 18 and a half years, and I had to say goodbye to a lot of dear friends. And the church that I spent most of my ministry in as their pastor, I had to tell them goodbye. It was a very difficult and hard thing to do. But that's when I got to come to Brindley Mountain Baptist Church to be your pastor. What a great year that was. But even in all the greatness, they were difficult things because that was the same year that my only nephew I had was killed in an accident. 4 days later in that year, my brother was killed in an accident. Things happen in a year. But through all those things, good times and bad times, God is there. He doesn't forsake us. He doesn't leave us. He's a part of our lives. So what is our vision? I thought about visions for just a moment. In the Bible, I think about, and I could have preached about it, Ezekiel talked about those dry bones. Where the Lord asked Ezekiel, can these dry bones live? I look at the church. I look at our community. I look at the ministry here in Brindley Mountain. Can these dry bones live? Yes, they can. Through Jesus Christ. He gave them the vision to see something that was impossible. But folks, I promise you, 2024 cannot be possible without the Lord. But through the Lord, great and marvelous things can and will take place. We look in the book of Revelation. John was given a vision. He was shown the judgment seat. He was shown the glory, the throne of God. What do we see coming into 2024? Isaiah 6, it talks about how Isaiah looked and he said, woe is me, for I am undone. God needs to open our eyes this morning to what the expectations that God has for us in 2024. You know, we may have our own expectation, but what is God's expectations for 2024? I can't say that I know exactly what they are, but I do know with God it's going to be something good. It's going to be something good. Look, I've been married, I told y'all, since 1979. Do the math, I think that's 40-something years, 46. I didn't do it. But when my wife goes to the kitchen and when she cooks, you know what I know? I don't know what she's going to cook, but I do know one thing. You can ask my daughters, when it's done, it's going to be something good to eat. It's going to be something good. I've spent many years with the Lord, and I know no matter what he does, it's going to be good. It's going to be good. I'm excited about that. So knowing that, we need to understand it, this year is a gift from the Lord. How are we going to embrace this year? How are we going to prepare ourselves for this year? And what goals are we going to set for ourselves in the year 2024? A lot of people, we do nothing. We just want to sit back, twiddle our thumbs, sit in the pew, and just let it happen. But folks, I think God has better plans than that. I think God wants to put things together. If we look at the very first part of this chapter, when he's talking about his unspeakable gift, in verse 1 of chapter 9, he said, "For as touching the ministering to the saints, it is superfluous," or it means it's really unnecessary for me to write unto you, "for I know the forwardness of your mind." That forwardness means your readiness, your willingness to go forward, "for which I boast of you, to them of Macedonia and to Achaia, was ready a year ago, and your zeal has provoked very many." You know what my goal is? To provoke some folks this year to experience what God has for them. People's asked me many times, and I'm just going to share with you in my Bible. People ask me, they'll say, "Preacher, what is your vision for the church? What is your vision for this year?" And in the back of my Bible, I wrote this several years back, and I've got it here, and this is mine. It says, "Vision. My vision for the church is a place where people can find God. I want Brindley Mountain Baptist Church to be a place where people can find God." Because they need God, don't they? They don't need to have a place where we don't need to have the best bouncy house in town. We don't need to have the best fellowship food in town. We need to be a church where people can find God. And the pastor, that's my vision for us this year. A place where people also can find God's purpose for their life. Not only find God, but God has a purpose for your life. Why am I here? Why am I experiencing the year 2024? What is the purpose that God has for me? We're here to help folks find that purpose for their life. The third thing I have here, a place to equip and assist them to pursue the mission that God has for them. Get them ready. Prepare them. I mean, we spend so much time with our young people, our children. They have ball practice on Monday night. They got ball practice on Tuesday night. They, you know, we preparing them to go to play in a ball game. But folks, I'm not saying anything wrong with that. But I'm saying as a church, we need to be preparing our young people and our young adults, our new Christians, to be able to go out and compete, to be ready for what's to come. Because they're going to be, listen, I promise you, I'm going to be challenged this year. You're going to be challenged. These young people are going to be challenged. And they need to be prepared for what comes. I like to know that I'm ready for what's to come. And I want to stir people up. I like what Hebrews said. "Let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works." So are we equipping ourselves? And a place, also the last one, a place to be loved and to belong. A place to be loved and belong. Folks, it's not good for man to live alone. It's not good for man to try to do his ministry and walk with the Lord by himself. We're here to do it together. You may not think you need anybody, but I'm going to let you know this somebody needs somebody. I need you. You need me. We need one another. So we want to provoke one another. Now, don't get me wrong. I think some Baptist churches, we're pretty good at provoking folks, but it's not in the right way. I heard one that's right. I can remember my wife, when we first married, she wore glasses back in those days. And I used to provoke her. She'd be sitting there trying to read, and I'd take and lick my finger and run it across her glasses. I still have knots back here on the back of my head, if you need to know. Sometimes we just like to provoke people, but not in a positive way, but in a negative way. Some people want to be right in the middle of the gossip. We want to be right in the middle of provoking people to anger, but we're here to provoke people to turn to the Lord, to trust the Lord, and to follow the Lord in their lives. That's what he said here. That's my desire. He says, I know your willingness. I know your eagerness. But I hope it's to provoke, I boast to be about you. And folks, I want to brag about a lot of the folks that we have here at Brindley Mountain Baptist Church, the great work that they do. I mean, look, there's people here all hours of the night sometimes working on doing something for the children and getting ready for some adult. They just did a program here the other day. Man, I'm proud of the people that we've got working. In fact, we're doing a little dinner. And if you're invited, you've got an invitation. It's tonight at 6 o'clock. We just want to thank you for your work. Because we need to provoke one another to do the right thing. The second thing, we need to be ready. Verse 3 says, yet have I sent to the brethren, lest our boasting of you should be in vain in this behalf, that as I said, you may be ready. Least happy if the Macedonians come with me and find you unprepared, we say not, you should be ashamed in the same confident boasting. Therefore, I thought it necessary to exhort. That means to urge the brethren that they would go before you and make up beforehand your bounty, whereof you have noticed before, that the same might be ready and are a matter of bounty and not of covetousness. You know, there's things that I may desire. Covet. But folks, I don't need to be coveting things. I just need to be following the plan that God has for me. And I need to be ready for whatever comes my way. I don't know what my wife has cook for today for me when I get home. I mean, I can sit here and think about it, and I'm thinking, man, what about a 3-layer chocolate-covered cake, you know, with some good cold milk? I can desire a bunch of stuff. But what do we really need? We need to be ready and prepared. Ready, ready. Can we say that we are ready for 2024, whatever it comes our way? There was a lady in the church I pastored down in Altoona. Name was Joan Payne. I started to play her on my phone for y'all, but every year on my birthday, Joan Payne calls me on my birthday and sings to me. She sings about like I do, but she sings to me every year on my birthday. And I got recordings on my phone. She is special that way. But let me tell you a little something else about Joan Payne. Joan Payne is ready for whatever comes. I've been at church, and all of a sudden we're doing something, and somebody will say, got a screwdriver? And she'll pull that purse out, and she'll have a screwdriver in her purse. Somebody's got a string hanging off their coat there. She'll pull out a pair of scissors. I believe if they wanted to know the voltage on the wall, she'd pull out a voltmeter. I mean, she has everything in her purse. She has prepared for whatever comes around. In fact, it would just become a joke that no matter when we turn around, somebody needed something, they'd say, Joan, is it in your purse? Because she had everything in her purse. Folks, that's the way we need to be in the year 2024. We need to have everything that we need to, no matter what Satan throws at us, life throws at us, we are prepared for it. Prepared for it. That's what he's telling about the church. We don't need to be a disappointment. We need to be ready. We don't need to be just coveting, hoping that we have a great year. We're just going to we're gonna say, I'm going to be ready for whatever comes our way. Whatever comes our way. Not only should we provoke folks in the positive way, not only should we be ready, but we need to be givers this year. In the year 2024, I pray that our vision is we're going to be given of ourselves. Verse 6, it says, but this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he that soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully, every man according to his he proposeth in his heart. So let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for the Lord loveth a cheerful giver. If I'm going to be pleasing to the Lord in 2024, I'm going to have to be a giver. Man, you get talking to a Baptist church about giving, and people go, oh, my goodness, now he's wanting money. It's not about money. It's about giving. It's a blessing in giving. Let me talk to you about giving just a moment. God gave his son. Jesus gave his life. An example for us to follow. What should I be doing in 2024? I need to be giving as God would have me to give. And give it cheerfully and joyfully, willingly. Lord, whatever you want me to give, I'm here to give. And said, once if we give like God would have us to give, there's no limits to what God can do with what we give. God bless us. God's going to bless us. I believe 2024 is going to be a blessed year because of the people giving and putting into it. So many people aren't expecting much out of the year because they hadn't put much into the year. What are we putting into it? How much effort are we going to put into it? How much prayer are we going to put into it? We're just carelessly going through life. So not only am I going to provoke folks in a good way, and am I going to be ready for whatever comes my way, I'm going to be giving, and I'm going to give willingly and cheerfully. And not only that, I'm going to follow a good example. I'm going to look for something great to take place. It says in verse 8, then God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always have all sufficiency in all things, may abound in every good work. Sufficient, able to do that. My wife came in my office a while ago, and she didn't want to know what was going on. She's looking at what's happening. On. A lot of times I have been given a task of watching our kids when they were younger, our grandkids when they came along. And I've even helped out in church and had to watch some of the young kids. And I'm thinking, what am I going to do? And you know, this is a popular thing to do. You give them a blank page, and you give them a crayon. He said, well, here, you can draw. And here's my experience. Most of the time, most of the kids, I give them a blank piece of paper and a crayon, and I tell them to draw. And they do this right here. And they say, I'm finished. I'm thinking, what is it? You didn't put no effort into it. You didn't put no strength into it. Well, I'm done. I hate to tell you, that's the way, this is what most of 2024 is going to look like for most folks, because you didn't put no effort into it. You didn't put no effort into it. So with those young folks, I turn around and I say, okay, let me give you some lines to kind of help you out with your drawing. Let me give you something that's already sketched out, and I want you to go, and I want you to work on that. And this is a pretty good one. This is Noah's Ark with some of the animals and the waters and the mountains and the sky. And I tell them, okay, go work on this. And I'd give it to my grandkids, and I come back, and this is what it looks like. I thought, you didn't stay inside the lines. You just sort of didn't take no effort. And they go back and they'll take a different color one. Okay, they put a different color on there. It still doesn't look any good. Listen, God's word gives us lines to stay in. We get outside those lines, our lives get to looking like this right here. But when we get staying inside the lines, all of a sudden it becomes a beautiful picture. Something that, now a lot of y'all, let me tell you, a lot of y'all grandkids will do that, and you'll say, oh, that's beautiful, and you put it on your refrigerator. That might be cute when you're little. But if my wife told me to paint this, and that's what I did, she's not going to put it on her refrigerator. She's going to say, I have expected more of you. I've seen that out there at Jack, where they'll give a little thing to color, and the kid's done it, and a lot of them looks this way, but some of them have gone and done a real good job. Stayed inside the line, and they put it up there and had their names on it. I hope that year 2024 that you're willing to put your name on what we've done. Because God's given us the ability to do it. We all are sufficient in what we're doing. And God's going to give us everything that we need. He said, abound much. He said, as it is written, he that disperses abroad, he hath given to the poor, his righteousness remaineth forever. It doesn't matter who we are. He's going to bless us all. He's going to bless us all. What are we going to do with his unspeakable gift? What are we going to do in 2024? We're just going to haphazardly go through it? Or are we going to do something that people are going to talk about for years to come? We concluded last Sunday, our last Sunday of the year, of Gideon. Let me see what Gideon said. I didn't share this, but I want to share it this Sunday. When the Lord was calling Gideon, this is what he said. He said, oh, my Lord, wherefore shall I save Israel? How am I going to do that? Behold, my family is poor in Manassas, and I am the least in my father's house. I can't make a difference. You know what Manassas stands for? What it really means? That name means to forget. To forget. He said, I come from a place that means to forget. Folks, we don't need to forget who we are. We don't need to forget that we're here for a purpose and a reason. We need to not forget that it's important to get a good start. And we're here today to get a good start. And we're here to make a year that's going to be lasting. It's going to be meaningful, not just to the Lord and to the kingdom, but for people's lives. What am I going to do? What are you going to do? It starts with a commitment. And I challenge you, I provoke you today to commit yourself to be what God wants you to be in 2024. I challenge you, I provoke you to be ready for whatever comes your way in 2024. So many times as a pastor, I spend more time trying to help folks because they weren't prepared for what came their way. But we're getting ahead of it. We're getting ahead of it. We don't need to react after it takes place. We need to be prepared before it comes. Let us pray together. Dear Lord, we're so thankful for a privilege to be able to have the sacred gift that you've given us. And your promise of being with us here this day, as you have blessed us for another year to begin. I pray, Lord, that we'll not wait till the end to start, that we'll not put things off, but, Lord, that we begin today, committing ourselves today. I pray, Lord, through your Holy Spirit and through your word, you have provoked us to take on the challenge to make ourselves ready. I pray, Lord, that you do that in our hearts and our lives. If there, we need to do something right where we stand during this invitation, or maybe we need to lay it on this altar, maybe we're at home today watching, wherever we may be, I pray, Lord, that you find us preparing ourselves for what you have for us this year. It's a blessing. In Jesus' name we pray and ask. Amen. If you'll stand together with me without any kind of delay, if God has put anything on your heart, provoked you in any way this morning, I pray that we respond as God would lead.
Come every soul.
Very quickly on the very first verse. You need to respond or commit this year. You need to respond in your life.
Trusting in His word. Only trust Him now.
Thank each of you for being here today. I want to thank Dane this morning for encouraging us through following and through baptism today. And I want to thank all the guests and visitors we have with us today. I just thank you for coming and joining us as we kick off this great year that the Lord has for us. And I just want to thank the Lord for all the blessings and the salvation He's provided for us. Anyone else have a word before we dismiss? My brother Darrell, dismiss his prayer, please, sir.
Our most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you, Lord, for all the many blessings, Lord. Thank you for the one today, Lord, confessing in you, Lord, and being baptized. Lord, be with our church, and Lord, thank you for the 2023 year, Lord, and Lord, that 2024, Lord, that we may be a light unto you, Lord. Go with us to our homes, lead and guide all these things I ask in your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.